On tonight's CTV News, infrastructure repairs are taking too long and costing too much. Questions are now being asked whether money's been wasted in the rebuild and if the City Council can afford to fund its projects. This is CTV News, I'm Grant Mangan. After three floods in just 10 weeks, the Christchurch City Council is promising to set up a task force that will work on short-term fixes. But some residents say the council is working too slowly.
Three floods down and no one wants to see a fourth. Residents are demanding their flood-prone land to be red-zoned. They say no one will want to buy their homes in their current waterlogged state. They've told the press the council and the mayor are acting too slowly, describing the mayor as backseat about the whole thing. One resident doesn't think the task force proposed by the mayor would achieve any timely solutions. She told the press it's an unfixable problem. This resident moved out of her house more than a year ago after mould started growing underneath. This was affecting her children's health, so she had no choice but to leave. She's surprised it's taken this long for the council to act and wants the government to help out. The mayor has told media options include localised pumps, flood barriers and raising floor levels. Flockton Basin options include widening or deepening Dudley Creek. Another option would be to install a pump station, but this could take at least 2 years to get underway. The mayor has ruled out red zoning the land. Instead, a potential option would be a voluntary offer to any residents who wish to take it up. The Prime Minister has told CTV News he knew of two or three people working on the proposal. The council has since confirmed 30 staff members are on the project. Hundreds of contractors are supporting them.
The Earthquake Minister is commissioning an independent report to find out whether money from infrastructure repairs is being wasted.
Wasted money on the city's rebuild is being questioned by the Earthquake Recovery Minister. Jerry Brownlee is commissioning an independent report focusing on the stronger Christchurch infrastructure rebuild team. The council-funded organisation is in charge of repairing Christchurch's roads and water sewage systems. The minister is looking to find if money spent repairing the city's quake-damaged roads and infrastructure is being wasted. Mr Brownlee believes investigating SKIRT is within the best interests of the ratepayers. He's concerned the escalating costs of the program could balloon to $3 million. The Star reports that Mayor Leanne Dalzell refused to respond to questions regarding Minister Brownlee's comments. But last week, she says the council was wasting money maintaining roads in the red zone, and SKIRT weren't able to produce some of the results they wanted because they weren't able to enter the red zone. Mr Brownlee says there was a pressing need for repairs to improve efficiency.
There is still $1.77 billion worth of work on roads and underground pipes to complete. Breaking news on the press website says there is a $400 million shortfall in funding. That may mean the government, Christchurch City Council and SKIRT may need to abandon or rethink some projects. These organisations are looking at ways to reduce costs by almost 30%. Councillor Rathmanji says that cost savings have reached their limit, and it's likely the council will need to find a significant sum of money to make up the shortfall. The council will struggle to find additional funds as they are already facing a major budget deficit. Today marks 4 years since Environment Canterbury councillors were sacked by the government and replaced with commissioners. Labour and Green Party MPs gathered in Cathedral Square, along with dozens of supporters, to highlight the loss of democracy.
A wreath and a plaque to mourn the loss of democracy since Environment Canterbury councillors were sacked by the government 4 years ago today. Commissioners were put in their place, led by Dame Margaret Basley, but no one here was doubting the work they're doing. Their only concern is that voters haven't been able to have a say.
I don't have any problem with the individual commissioners or the work that they are doing. That is not the point. What I am concerned about and what thousands of Cantabrians are concerned about is that we don't have a democratic right to vote for them.
About 150 of those potential voters gathered in Cathedral Square today to lay wreaths and hold a moment of silence for the loss of democracy. 4 years ago, thousands were in the same spot to place river stones in this cairn. The stones are from rivers around the region and symbolise the commissioners coming into power.
The democracy has been taken away from Christchurch, no question about it. If there's a change of government, then Cantabrians will get their democracy back. If there's not, then they've got Jerry Brownlee.
Ruth Dyson says both the Greens and Labor have written to the United Nations about their concerns.
We believe that the United Nations should have it drawn to their attention. They haven't responded in the past. They may not be aware of the fact that an initial short-term intervention has now turned out to have been extended. So we've written to them and asked them to take action.
Green MP Eugenie Sage is in a unique position of being a former Environment Canterbury councillor and a sitting Green MP. She was sacked along with her fellow regional councillors. Elections were first postponed to last year, but now they've been delayed until 2016. Eugenie Sage says if the Green Party is a part of the government come this year's election, they will repeal the ECAN legislation.
What the cairn is about is people wanting a say in their future, in the future of the management of our rivers and aquifers. We should have got the vote back by now. The emergency is long since over. People need a vote.
Local Government Minister Judith Collins was unavailable for comment today, but a review is underway into the future governance arrangements of ECAN. The government will be releasing a discussion document shortly, inviting the people of Canterbury to have their say on what should happen when the commissioners finish their term in 2016. Marcus Gibbs, CTV News.
The murderer of Christchurch sex worker Mallory Manning was sentenced today. Marcus Gibbs spoke to a seasoned prostitute about the sentencing and how safe the streets are as a place to work.
Just hours after the sentencing of a mongrel mob gang prospect for the murder of a Christchurch sex worker, Tarns was back on the street. The seasoned prostitute has been calling Manchester Street her place of work since she was in her early 20s. Today she was glad to hear Mallory Manning's murderer wouldn't be out of prison for at least 20 years.
Sentencing today, she should have got more, but it's 20 years is better than nothing. He's a prick, sorry.
Tan says the 2008 murder shook the girls up.
Oh, we all scouted. There wasn't many of us at all for a while. They're all coming back now, but he wasn't at the time, no. It's a bit scary.
Police have issued a statement following the sentencing. Detective Senior Sergeant Brian Archer says the investigation remains open and active. He says police are continuing to actively pursue the other people associated with the murder. Archer's urging anyone with information about the other offenders to contact police.
Well, it was pretty clear in the trial for Mallory Manning that there was a drugs debt there. But, you know, what's a few hundred dollars when you're talking about somebody's life?
Despite today's sentencing, violent attacks on Manchester Street are still happening from time to time. New Zealand Prostitute Collective co-founder Anna Reid told CTV's Street Stories two recent assaults on the street brought back the memories of fear. Just before Christmas, Tarns was also sexually assaulted while working.
Yeah, took me to his house and yeah, he was a prick.
Tarns is hoping anyone with information about the death of Mallory Manning comes forward. Marcus Gibbs, CTV News.
And Marcus Gibbs' controversial Street Stories program on prostitutes will repeat on Tuesday, the 6th of May, for viewers who missed it. The next 20 years of development is being planned for Rolleston Township, including the Foster Recreation Park.
Selwyn District Council has adopted master plans for the Rolleston Town Centre and Foster Recreation Park. The Town Centre master plan focuses on developing a heart for Rolleston. This includes the development of a new library, community and technology centre, a town square and road layout changes. There's 19 hectares of additional retail and commercial land in the draft. Houses along the north side of Tenson Street will be rezoned to commercial land within 5 years. The Foster Recreation Park master plan will see the park become the largest sport and recreation centre in Selwyn. 372 submissions were received on the plans during consultation last year. They show a high level of support for the overall concept and direction of the plans. The submissions have resulted in some changes to the plans and timing of projects. Foster Park will now feature a skate park and an area where dogs can exercise off the leash. Walking and cycling tracks around the edge of the park and a health and fitness centre are brought forward to be developed in the first stage of works. The Clock Tower Reserve will not be used for retail activities. Instead, further discussions with the community will determine the best use of the space. Rolleston is one of the fastest growing towns in New Zealand. Its population doubled between 2005 and 2013 and will double again by 2030. The new master plans are intended to cater to this growth. They'll be implemented in stages over the next 20 years.
Coming up, local researchers are leading the way with bridge technology, creating structures that will survive earthquakes unscathed.
Al Jazeera News. International news right off the satellite, bringing you up-to-the-minute coverage of world events. Al Jazeera News. Weekday mornings at 6 o'clock, right here on CTV.
Missed a show or want to watch it again? CTV is fitting in with your lifestyle. Be in control with CTV On Demand. Check out our website and follow the links. ctv.co.nz.
When it comes to the delicate subject of funeral services, Ashburton now has another option. Galbraith Funeral Services now offer you and your family their high standard of service and expertise in their offices in Havelock Street. Whether it's a chat about pre-booking a service to include all your ideas and thoughts for your own funeral or that of another member of the family, or simply asking what's involved, call or pop in. Galbraith Funeral Services is an old firm with old-fashioned values, ensuring all the options are yours.
Here, an opportunity of a lifetime has arisen. A chance for you to live, work, play and relax in the heart of New Zealand's adventurous alpine environment. The Drive is a stunning lifestyle subdivision nestled between the Twizel Township and the renowned Lake Rua Taniwha. Starting from just $135,000, each section allows stunning views and offers the potential to develop your very own piece of utopia. For more information, visit mckenzieproperties.co.nz.
Located at the foot of the Port Hills, Berrymead Golf offers a spectacular location for any occasion. Make a dream wedding a reality with private use of our green function room, outdoor garden courtyard, large marquee and stunning gazebo. Or for your next conference, enjoy the relaxed atmosphere of Berrymead Golf, offering a private, spacious conference room with special deals to make any break a true break. All with customised catering from the WOW Cafe. Berrymead Golf, 50 Berrymead Park Drive, right next to the Berrymead Heritage Park.
The Home Show Spa Pool Sale is on. Hi, Mike from Four Seasons. Save $2,000 on Spa Pool 947 with all the features. Spas from just $5,499 with savings up to $4,000. Home Show Sale on now at Four Seasons Home and Leisure, Tower Junction Mega Centre.
Arts 21 showcases the vast creative talent and minds that are making a name for themselves in Europe and beyond. Think outside the square with Arts 21. Monday morning at 10:30.
Christchurch Hospital has recently received a generous donation of equipment from a supermarket appeal.
Each year, the Christchurch Hospital becomes a second home for thousands of local children. And with a small donation at the supermarket counter, the equipment and toys used in the children's ward is updated and renewed annually. This year, Countdown's Kids Appeal donated over $100,000 to Christchurch Hospital's children's ward. This phototherapy light is state-of-the-art, helping babies who are jaundiced.
So what we do is put them in their bassinet or an incubator and turn the lights on. They shine blue, and it's one of the wavelengths of the sunlight, because in the old days they used to put babies out in the sun. But this is safer and much more effective.
The LED light is new technology being used on the wards and better than the old equipment they are currently using.
It's essential these days. We're very fortunate to have this kind of machine. It makes our job a lot easier and it keeps the children a lot safer.
And this docking machine alone costs $5,000, and the ward has just received six brand new ones thanks to the donation.
Well, where I work, I look after the children who have various cancers, and so it means that when we're running chemotherapy, we can run multiple lines, pain relief and those sorts of things.
Along with the new technology, dozens of new toys to help with children's development have also been donated to the department. Emma Cropper, CTV News.
The University of Canterbury are working on state-of-the-art, quake-safe bridge technology.
It's a leading design for the future of quake-safe bridges, testing how their strength and structure holds up during earthquakes.
This means that we can't control the earthquake, but we can control the structure.
What you see here is a half-scale bridge being pushed and pulled, as it would when a quake hits. But the difference between this design and many of those already built is the foundations. They're not locked down and move with the shaking ground.
It means it protects your column, so you see that there's nothing happening in the column, it's just the column rocking normally. But if you're trying to prevent that movement, like the way that we do in traditional design, that we're locking it with the footing, at this movement you will see lots of cracking happening in the columns.
The new technology also means the entire bridge would be fitted with large rubber bands, helping with the structure's stability.
And so these rubber bands are pretty much providing self-centering capacity to the system. So that means that if, for example, we have an earthquake going in this direction, what's happening is that the bridge is moving like this as an articulated system. And if you look at the bottom of the column, you see that the column is rocking over this foundation pad.
Dr. Alessandro Palermo is leading the research, along with a team of the Canterbury University students and trained staff. They have just 1 year left of their 4-year project and hope to see the state-of-the-art technology on land by the end of next year. Dr. Palermo believes building bridges that survive earthquakes barely unscathed will help immediately in the aftermath for residents.
If we have a bridge which doesn't have damage after the earthquake, that means that we don't have to close the bridge even for 1 week. That means that you can drive easily and you don't have to worry to do a detour and go in another part of the to go to that part of the city by doing a different route. So that is what we are aiming for.
Having first-hand experience of quake-damaged bridges in Christchurch has aided the students' findings to create the best technology.
I can see the damage in the structure and then I can correlate and support it based on my knowledge and justify it in some way, you can say, by the numbers. But imagine yourself that the building or the bridge hasn't gone through any earthquake and you're coming up with numbers for it, that this is the capacity, here's going to be the deal. I think most of those things will be based on theory only. You need to have some experimental investigations to back up your conclusions.
How these bridges hold up during an earthquake will lead the way for bridge designs around the globe. Emma Cropper, CTV News.
Still to come, this week's business update, traffic report and weather forecast.
Be immersed in the unique cultural highlights Germany has to offer every Tuesday night with Discover Germany. Tuesday at 7 p.m. right here on CTV.
We all know the best thing you can do for your body is eat fresh foods in their natural state. The same applies to your skincare. Southern Skin provides a skincare range with fresh, locally sourced ingredients, plus natural preservatives and emulsifiers to produce the best nourishment for your skin to unleash your healthiest complexion. New Zealand Olive and Aloe Skincare, for young or old, men, women and children. There is a product in the Southern Skin range for you. southernskin.co.nz.
Avoid the monkeys when it comes to relocating. Trust A1 Movers, a family business since 1993 that guarantees a professional job every time. We carefully handle and wrap your valued items, ensuring they have a safe journey. Secure storage and insurance options are also available.
A1 Movers, the careful, caring moving company.
Oi!
Hi, I'm Steve and welcome to Carpet Kingdom. At Carpet Kingdom, we stock a massive range of carpets and we're also the largest vinyl stockist in the South Island. And not only do we have an excellent range in store, but you can purchase our stock online. We offer free measure and quotes, we have our own installation team, we ship nationwide, so come on down and see us at Carpet Kingdom. 312 Wilson's Road in Waltham, just off Bryham Street, or visit us online at carpetkingdom.co.nz.
Christchurch has its very own enchanted utopia, the Hitching Post. Pop in and see for yourself. A magical assortment of handmade creations, custom-made candles and artwork. Choose from our huge range of water features, garden art and imported giftware. Specialists in handcrafted metal artwork made in store. nestled on 722 Marshlands Road. The Hitching Post, defining art our way.
Be watching CTV News first at 5 and you could win up to $5,000 every week with CTV's cash giveaways. For more information, visit our website and be watching CTV News first at 5.
Here's Warren Head with this week's business news.
Hi, I'm Warren Head from headliner.co.nz. It's been mostly a positive week for the financial markets. It began with ASB Bank coming out with their economic survey, indicating that the growth rate of the country's economy was likely to be fairly much on track towards 3.5%, maybe even 4% this year. Everything seemed to be signalling there that there's more good things to come. Dairy prices had come off a bit in the auctions online, and that had been absorbed in their expectations. Of course, however, today out came the rather stunning news that the burgeoning infant milk formula market, in which some Canterbury producers have had quite a vested interest, has had a serious knock with the Chinese administration canning most of the import licenses for infant milk formula into the country from 1st of May. We have about 100 companies who have been doing that. About 50 of them are small, but they have about 70 brands in that sense that there's more brands than there are businesses. The Chinese were confused about how this came back to control over manufacturing processes. They have tightened up on all of their international importing, and only 5 companies out of 13 of those big exporters into the China market have been approved entry. They were, of course, led by Fonterra. And then there was a company in Auckland called Sutton Group, linked with GMP Pharmaceuticals, and Danone's Nutrition Company, very big one, and a Waikato company, Dairy Goat Cooperative. Missing from the list is Canterbury's Synlait Milk. I guess there'll be a statement along in due course about that and what their prospects are in terms of getting regulatory approval for that market. There's been interest in the banks, particularly since the Labor Party came out with its fresh formula for the economy and wanting to tack on to the Reserve Bank's duties another mechanism which would help control costs of housing. Lots of debate about that, and it'll become quite a political talking point going forward and a little bit too complicated to get into here tonight. But it will throw attention back onto the banks, because there was some suggestion that why pay interest to Australian banks when you could simply cut your interest costs through this new mechanism. Well, out came the ANZ Bank today with a statutory profit for the last quarter in New Zealand of $853 million, up about 31%. Quite breathtaking, isn't it? Indicating, of course, that the economy is going well. Growth in income for the bank coming from home loans, more lending to commercial and export businesses as well, rapid growth in KiwiSaver, and generally just an improving picture overall. My take on it is I think we should stop knocking the Australian banks, their Australasian banks, and I'm pretty pleased they're as solid as they are. 5 years ago, we were the only part of the world that had solid banks, so good on them. Let's hope they stay as sound as they are, because I think it's a good thing. Would you have them any other way? Really? Really? I don't think so. And finally, just to comment on Oceana Gold, it came out with quarterly results. A good one. Market went up in that stock, almost a $59 million profit for the quarter, revenue up $170 million. They commented about the little mishap with the wall down there that caved in the open pit, halted underground mining for a bit. That's been restored, and they've been working off their ore reserves in the meantime. The gold output was 56,000 ounces across their two mines in New Zealand, at Reefton and at Central Otago, down a bit on the previous quarter. And these mines are trending down overall, but that was seen as a positive. And on that note, I think we'll move through to Friday. I'm Warren Head for headliner.co.nz.
If you're driving around the central city, CTV's traffic update will assist you navigating the repairs taking place.
Hello travellers, to help you plan your journey around the central city, here's another update on what's happening with the roads this week. Right now, Chilham Street's closed from Colombo Street to Manchester. A detour is in place down Colombo Street, Lichfield and Manchester. It's restricted to eastbound traffic from High Street to Madras Street. St. Asaph Street is down to one lane from Fitzgerald Avenue to Manchester Street. The best east and west route along this side of the city is Morehouse Avenue. Keep watching CTV News First at 5 for the latest updates. And in the meantime, visit the Transport for Christchurch website.
And don't forget, the updates also screen here on CTV at 7, 8 and 9 a.m. in the morning and also at 12 midday. And finally for tonight though, your regional weather.
Good evening, let's take a look at your region's weather. Starting in South Canterbury, Timaru 15 and into Mooka and Geraldine 16. Slightly cooler in Ashburton 15 and also in Rakaia 15. Next up, Darfield, Leeston and Rolleston 15 degrees today, Lincoln 15. And in the Garden City, a nice day to get out in the sun, a mild 15. Over in Akanoa 15. And crossing over to the Waimakariri, Rangiora and Kaiapoi 15. And heading slightly north to Amberley 15. Hiranui had the high of the day, Hanmer Springs and Culverton hit 17, as well as towards the east coast in Cheviot 17, up the very top in Kaikoura 15. But what about tomorrow, first up in Timaru? Fine weather for your Friday, but with high cloud and northeasterly breezes. Tonight's low 6 and expect a high tomorrow of 16 degrees. Canterbury, Ashburton. Another fine day ahead, but with plenty of high cloud about and the usual northeasterlies. Tonight's low 6 and tomorrow's high 16. And in the Garden City, Christchurch, you've got high cloud increasing for your Friday, with northeasterly winds developing during the day. Tonight's low will hit 8 and tomorrow's high will be 16. Colder, sunny periods at first, but high cloud for most of the day with northeasterly winds developing. Tonight's low 5, tomorrow's high 17. And in other areas, it's looking cloudy around the region, Geraldine and Temuka 17. Methven 17 with some cloud, and the same for Rakaia 17. Slightly cooler in Darfield, Leeston and Rolleston on 16. Lincoln expects some cloud with a high of 16 and a low of 6. Akaroa the same, a high of 16 and a low of 6. In North Canterbury, Rangiora and Kaiapoi, a high of 16 and a low of 6 also. Looking at Amberley now, cloudy with a high of 16. Hiranui can expect the high of the region with 18 degrees and also the low expecting 4 overnight. But looking ahead for Canterbury, mostly fine and sunny on Saturday with scattered high cloud and light winds. High cloud increasing and thickening on Sunday with moderate northeasterlies, scattered light rain may develop at night. Fresh breezy northeasterlies on Monday with mostly cloudy skies and scattered rain at times during the day. Fresh cold southwesterly winds on Tuesday, with a period of rain clearing during the afternoon. Mostly fine and sunny on Wednesday, with milder temperatures and moderate northeasterlies. Now that's all for your region's weather. Do enjoy the rest of your evening.
And that is CTV News for Thursday. I'm Grant Mangan. Good night.
supporting local content so you can see more of New Zealand on air.